We are here to generate bodhicitta, a certain kind of spiritual familiarity. Okay, I'm a huge advocate of this because it's working for me. Even though you may not quite understand, you're hearing it, but you know, is anything happening? Yes, it is. It's gradually sinking in. We put like stain on a wood or some sort of oil on real hard wood, but it gradually sinks in. And if you wet the wood before, wet it, and so it sort of expands a little bit, then the stain gets in even better. So there are ways to penetrate the hardness of our hearts, the hardness of our minds, the ego. There's ways for truth to gradually filter into that. And it's the most important usage of your time is to continuously keep paying attention to high spiritual truths. The gurus are great because just their pictures, just the ambience is that gets sent through to you somehow. Others can be helpful as well. But the gurus, again, it's more potent. Doesn't matter what they say. They're waking you up. That's right. This is true. However, what they say is also helpful. So we want to mirror this and amplify this and be cheerleaders for this. Spent a lot of time last night working on Take Satsang, facebook.com/Take Satsang. Posting a lot of graphics there. I was being very creative last night. For some reason, they didn't go over to my timeline, Clarity Ross. They didn't go over. Usually, they post there, too. This time, they didn't do it. I can't figure out why. Grace of God, I guess. So, nobody's looking at them. But that's okay. Because why? Because I'm generating bodhicitta by doing this, you see? So, it's not how many people you reach and what you're doing. When you try to help others, you're helping yourself, actually. Because I have to come up with this focus, right? An intent. The intent has to be there. So I'm locked in. That's super helpful for me. And if nobody looks, you know, still I get the benefit. And down the road, this will help others. But most of the stuff on Facebook and in the world altogether is just spirituality. Okay. Now, it's helpful. It can be helpful. It generates some bodhicitta. But it's not really deep enough. Okay? This is what I see very clearly. I've always seen this here. It's avoiding. It's kind of like, yeah, I'll go almost all the way, but nah, I want to stall out. This is the world, okay? This is all of us. I might be an exception to it at this point. But it is all of us. This is why we use caffeine. It's a stall out drug. I don't use caffeine. I say, no, I don't want to stall out. This is my final quote unquote birth in a realm. So I better realize why. Okay. So all of that is helpful, but it's kind of like, you let it get into you, and then there's still this area within your mind that you don't let anything into. You don't let the truth into it. This is everybody here, with few exceptions. So, this area that we don't allow any truth to enter. What do we do about that? Well, we have to start working on that. And this seems difficult because we're so used to that being the limits, we've off limits, that we seem clumsy and awkward. So the trouble with all this spirituality is it generates these polished devotees, but they still have this off limits area, okay, within their mind, which is the crucial area. So they're very polished at avoiding that, and they're very polished at being devotees. So when they start trying to look at this and allow truth into this, they seem stupid. They seem awkward. And they lose their devotee polish, so to speak. They don't really lose it. It's just kind of on the back burner because they're awkward again. So this is the tough part of the path. It's like somebody who's a really good pitcher, and injure their arm, and they have a real difficult time coming back. They've lost their confidence. They've lost this, and they have to, at some point, they have to realize, to humble themselves and say, you know what? I got to start over again in terms of my determination and will. And I thought I had it, but I don't have it right now. I thought I had it. So there is this big, big trouble, which is really I call it the yoga girl thing, the devotee thing, is to develop polish at being a devotee, a spiritual devotee. This actually acts as a great barrier, hindrance to your realization. And we all do it. We all do it. So you will go through this time of dark night of the soul. St. John on the Cross, I think, said something like that. As you thought you were really something, you're really spiritually smart and polished, and then you feel like you don't know anything. Don't know anything. You're back to being an amateur again. So that's really tough to take, isn't it? I've certainly been through that. And it goes on and on. You say, oh my gosh, I'm such a knucklehead. I'm such an amateur. Everybody else is now way more polished than I am. Yeah, but they're just polishing glass to try to make it look like it's a diamond. And what you're going toward now is actually the diamond mine. Vajradhara, Vajrasattva, diamond mine. Not polishing the glass. This is very different. So when you're willing to do this, that's when the heavyweights, gurus, show up in your life. They know. They know. Okay, here's someone who is humbled themselves and is just getting down to work and business and going for diamond mind. Yeah. They know. They know. So this spiritual devotees will have pictures, they'll have anecdotes, they'll have quotes, they'll have this. But when you really get down, humble yourself, and start to work on this off-limits area, then you literally meet these gurus. They show up in your dreams. They show up somehow, powerfully. They welcome you to the club. You know, say, hey, you're an apprentice. You know, you're an apprentice to the court of the Dharma King now. And they start pulling you into the court of the Dharma King. You start becoming part of the court of the Dharma King. This is how it works. And so what's happened is you notice on Facebook there's this polish that they're all very used to. The quotes, the teachers, and all of this, and it's like they're polishing the glass, dusting and making it real, real clean, cleaning the windows, cleaning the windows, cleaning the windows. But there's still a window there in their mind, you see. And this is a stall out technique. So what we do is we humble ourselves every day. And today, yesterday's gone. Today I'm an amateur again. I don't know. So I'm going to be knocked out today somehow. Something's going to really knock me out today. So the polished devotees, they're trying to go towards nothing knocks me out. You know, no. I mean, spiritual. Yeah, I know spiritual truth. Nothing knocks me out. I've got it. You know, I'm used to it. I'm this is. So I've always seemed lowly spiritually in the world. I don't have the polish that others have. That's because I'm doing the real work, which is knocking me out and knocking me into the wow constantly. And I'm, you know, stumbling and bumbling and awkward. It's like, oh, you, wow. And others are holding conferences and giving talks about this, and you know, and they sound so knowledgeable and smooth, and I'm, you know, and who are you? You know, they, to me, it's like they say, who are you? You know, what have you done? What have you published? What have you, you know? What have, you got no polish, you know? Where's your bodhicitta? Well, the bodhicitta is in the moment of humility and wowness, and willing to sit patiently with the wowness. That's the bodhicitta. That's the polish. That's the real polish. But they don't see that. They don't see it. The world will not see this. They're trying to have their cake and eat it too, is to have some of the mind enlightened and some of it still off limits to enlightenment. Because they want a role for the body. They want a role. I think I need to do something with the body. And so they keep this off limits area. This is all of us. Okay, so we're not trying to say that someone's, we're just all inclusive with this basically. This is what we do. This is our trouble. That's why Jesus said the first will be last and the last will be first. This is what he's talking about. He always point out that it's the self-righteousness of the Sadducees and the Pharisees. These were these yoga girl spirituality slick devotees. He says, no, those are the last, that attitude, that'll get you there last. And then he always championed the humble, simple, humble ones who repented and who are working on this crucial area that's been off limits, and so they don't seem to be very much spiritually to the world. So these are the ones that'll be first into the kingdom of heaven. And this is true. It's absolutely true. Jesus is a super heavyweight. He's very much ignored on Facebook. Very much ignored. Only the kitschy Christians do something with Jesus. But Jesus' real teachings are virtually ignored on Facebook because they give you very little oomph towards, you know, being a slick devotee. And they pull you right into this. Jesus says, look at this. And you go, oh, I'm not so good at looking at that. I mean, I remember Course in Miracles, and I struggle. I still struggle. It's like, what is he saying? You know, what is this? What are you talking about? Because this is not part of my slick spiritual act. You know, I don't know these lines. I don't know if I can read these lines very good in my role of being a spiritual devotee, of being spiritually knowledgeable. It doesn't really fit that way. I said, what the heck are you talking about, Jesus? And yet I knew what he's saying is right. I just said, I'm not sure. I don't look, you're not making me look good. You don't make me look so good, Jesus. So he's ignored. Amazing. It's mostly all Eastern teachers. And all, you know, the quotes that they, there's nothing wrong with that. I get benefit from that too, because they're but Jesus is really, if I want to go to the heaviest teaching, I go to Jesus actually. He's been more detailed and more, you know, he's willing to put it out on the line, even though he's being ignored now. So that's how great his teaching. His teaching is so focused on this area that we wall off, so focused at looking at that, that most of us ignore him. And it's no. I want to keep polishing the glass and make it look, you know, like a diamond. I don't really want to do this. That's too difficult. I don't want to look like I'm ignorant. This is all politics is spiritual politics. And so many people who've had university educations and stuff, they've just been taught how to polish the glass. That's all. I realized in seventh grade I was finished with school. It was a scam. It was a sham. It's not for me. I said, I got to get to this area that's taboo, that's, you know, off limits. I got, and they're not going to ever there's no inclination on anyone's part in the schooling system, in the university system, the educational system in the world, no inclination whatsoever to get to this area. Zero. So if you hang around those folks, you're not going to get to it. Now, you'll get the clever quotes about the oneness and consciousness and all this stuff, but you won't really get to realization. And you'll get old and you'll die and, you know, go through the Bardo. You'll just go through it all. You'll transmigrate. That's what happens. And you just keep transmigrating until you get to this area. So getting to this is a little bit awkward. So what we introduce is the wow. This frees you from the awkwardness. It frees you from it. Because you're not struggling with the struggle. The wow itself is acknowledgement there's a struggle here. Wow. Okay? So you start by acknowledging your insufficiency, your struggle, your awkwardness. This is where you start. And we wrap that all together in a bundle and we call it just the wow. This is the wow. And we just full stop in this wow and just, yeah. It's a beautiful experience and feeling. We're no longer having to put on airs. Oh, okay, I got it. No, we don't say we got it here. We say I'm wowing it. I'm wowing it. So this whole, all of this here is to help those who are really are finished with transmigration. This is real core spiritual practice here, is we start with the wow. This is what's all important here. Otherwise, we're just spinning our wheels. So now I do all this extemporaneously. It's a wow because I say, wow, it's awkward. It's I'm struggling. It's not smooth. It doesn't sound like somebody, rattling off, introducing a Rinpoche or something and all the inside jokes and this and this. Oh, yeah, I know how the, this. It's a very smooth presentation. Everybody's, oh, this is slick. No, it's just. It's ragged, but it's right. So we start with the wow. But we have the key practice. We have the key to realization here, actually. The others are just polishing, the lock, the deadbolt on the door. You know, they're polishing the deadbolt, gleaming brass. And they come and look at the door. So look how much that brass is gleaming on that deadbolt. I really nailed it. You know, wow, what a great house I got. Except they don't have the key. They can't get inside the house. We have the key here. We can get inside the house. So we're not really concerned how polished the brass is on the deadbolt of the door. So we have the key and we open the deadbolt and say, well, wow. You know, that's wow. We can actually, and we open the door and we realize we're already inside. So this is like a Nasruddin sort of little story of somebody's polishing the brass. Rags got a little special spray, you know, Brasso. And they say, look at this deadbolt. You see any rust there? No. Ah, no rust. Clean, pure. It's a pure deadbolt, isn't it? And they got this whole thing about the deadbolt, how pure it is, how clean it is, how shiny it is. Look how it reflects the light. Look how. And they set up a marketplace selling, you know, this Brasso and the cleaning cloths and all sorts of, they take pictures of it. They post it on Facebook and all that stuff. Look at my deadbolt. I got the best deadbolt in town. And we're like, who cares what the deadbolt looks like? I mean, I don't care at all. Is it rusty? I don't care if it's rusty, if it's not shiny. It makes no difference. We're picking the lock. We're picking the lock, you see. We got this key. We'd be able to pick the lock and get this key that works. This wow key. Wow is the key to the deadbolt. That's all we're interested in. And the lockness is this area of that we put off limits. This locks the door. It's off limits. So we're saying, no, it's not off limits. We're looking at it. And this is opening it. But first you have to have the key, which is this full stop in the wow, which is acknowledgement of our awkwardness and lack of polish here as we look at this off limits area. Because we haven't looked at it before. We haven't really looked at it. And we don't know what to do about it. We're not slick. We're not polished. You know, we're ragged. And so we lump all of these reactions together right up front and say, yeah, we're going to have this wow. We're going to be in the wow as we're talking here. And so the polish we have is just sitting quietly. This is what's key. So we don't want to be without any polish at all. See, we don't want to seem too awkward. Okay. So the brilliance of this approach is our polish is just sitting quietly like this. Just sit quiet. That's the polish. If we try to be a professional devotee, we'll seem awkward, won't we? Because we'll be stumbling in our thoughts and our words. We're not sure because we're like, wow, I'm not used to this. This is really amazing. Oh, and we're just vibrating like... So we're not the polished devotee who's so slick in rattling off the terms and the dropping the names and just has to, you know, just the spokesperson as so slick. We're not that. So it would be too much for us if we didn't have some way of at least appearing to have a little bit of polish, right? We don't want to seem to be idiots because we're not, right? So our polish is just sitting here quietly, but without trying to be polished in our quiet sitting. Okay, this is very simple, isn't it? I mean, you don't want to become, the goal is to be a professional devotee and sitting quietly, obviously. It's just that we have a little bit of polish in sitting quietly in terms of, yeah, we can sit quietly, but we're not like, you know, in some perfect asana with our hair pulled back into a bun just right, eyebrows just right, makeup just right, just enough makeup on the eyes, you know, looking like fresh and dewy, and, you know, your hands like this, and everything's, and we're like this, and we say, look what a professional devotee I still am. No, we're dropping that. We're dropping the professional devotee-ness. I see people, you know, hiking or running or jogging. They got all these professional shirts and clothes, everything they know. I don't know. I said, what shirt am I supposed to wear when I'm hiking? I don't know. I have no idea. So I just wear, you know, just a regular kind of nice golf shirt or something. Probably look at me like, what the heck? What is that? Yeah, it's ragged. You know, I don't know. I'm not a professional hiker. I'm not a professional sit-stiller. Okay, but I have a little bit of polish, like maybe I have a good pair of boots or something. Okay, well, so I have a little bit of polish in that I sit quietly for long periods of time, just sitting quietly. Just sit quietly. And what we are, we're dedicated to not doing anything. We're not trying to be this perfect statue of yogic asana stillness or anything. Okay, no. So again, people look at it and say, oh, you know, they're not very good at yoga or sitting quietly, not, you know, but you know, we're doing a little bit of it. And people just, okay. So you won't get the approval of others on the spiritual path. You will not get it. The professional devotees look down their nose at you. They most certainly do. This is what I've experienced here for 60 years. All of the professional spiritual people have looked down their noses at me. Most definitely, to the point of just dismissing me, like, oh, he doesn't know, he doesn't have it. And I say, yeah, well, let's look at this together. Can we look at this? Oh, you know, oh yeah, you know, what, oneness? Yeah, oneness. I remember a quote by, Krishnamurti about oneness. So they go right into their professional devotee act, you know. I said, no. I mean, let's really just sit here and just look at this and let's see what we don't get about it. I mean, where are we stuck? What are we keeping apart from truth? Where are the barriers? She says, oh, no, yeah, let's see. And then they think for another quote. Yeah, oh, yeah, that reminds me of someone, saying that that all barriers are also oneness or something. Okay. So they stay in their professional devotee act. Continuously. Their whole lives is a professional devotee act. And we're getting real good at that. This is the yoga girl thing, is that they like this. Really, it's to the benefit of the ego and egoic delusion and comfort and control and nature likes this. It benefits the search. It keeps the search going. Makes us feel less threatened by an abyss. Excuse me. And so the world is engaged in this, but we cannot be entirely engaged in that. We can use, there's nothing wrong with these quotes. Those can help us also. And the pictures, but it's the attitude that's important. And the attitude is to be meek. Jesus said the meek shall inherit. Well, you should, I don't know if they said the earth, but the kingdom. It's about meekness, spiritual meekness. That Jesus was so adamant about this and so clear about it. Because this is the attitude you have to have as you really are looking at what needs to be looked at. Because you're kind of going to feel like a little ant, because you just really are not used to this. And your professional devotee-ness is like shattered. But so most in the world are simply striving to be professional devotees. They're professionals in their lives. Their education has taught them to be professionals, professional bluffers, basically. Mostly they're professional bluffers. A lot of education is just bluffing. Projecting confidence. The yoga girls are very good at projecting confidence. They're the best at that, perhaps. There's some guys, yoga guys, are also good at that. And I don't mean just spiritualized. I mean in culture in general. The modern mindset, especially among the yoga girl mindset, is they train themselves to project confidence. There's nothing behind it. They're just bluffing. It's like marketing. You project confidence in your product, confidence in your company, project confidence. So the world is mostly toward just projecting confidence in superficiality and saying, yeah, we got it. And I'm saying, no, you don't. No, you don't. I said, what are you talking about? Who are you? Who are you? I don't know you. Where'd you get your degree? I said, degree? What? A degree in bluffing? I don't have a degree in bluffing. Well, you'll never amount to anything. That's the self-righteous Sadducees and Pharisees that Jesus condemned so severely. He said, the meek shall inherit the kingdom. Poor in spirit. When he said those poor in spirit, meaning like us, that we're not professional devotees, don't have all these costumes and rituals, and we're really, slick. No, we're just sitting here, hanging out in the suburbs, waking up in the morning at 3:30 in the morning, 2:30, 3:30 in the morning, can't sleep. And start to say, okay, maybe I need to look at something I haven't looked at yet. And feeling very fragile and under duress. I always feel under duress and fragile and like I'm not making it. I'm really failing. I got to work. you know, got to start at 3:30 in the morning, and so I did. So again, we're in this wowness here. These are the real devotees. These are the true ones, who the meek, humble in heart, meek in spirit. They put the wowness up front. This is what we start with. I'm like almost undone, you know. I'm just unraveled. But I'm letting the truth come in, and I'm just don't know what to do about it. I feel stupid. I kind of feel like awkward, like a child. I don't really know how to be in a slick adult, you know, like that. But Jesus says, be like a child. See, the children are not slick like adults, are they? They're willing to be wowed. Like, wow, this is amazing. I don't know what to do about this. Let me just be like that child. Not the slick adult. So without this attitude, there's no way that anyone will succeed. This is what Jesus points out. He's so clear about it. Without this putting the wow first, there's no way any of us will succeed. Not possible. Nobody knows I'm a spiritual aspirant in my social circles of the world, which I don't really have any. But nobody suspects anything. I'm just some lowly, humble failure of a person, kind of. Not maybe nice, and you know, but I try to be nice, and that's it. I'm not attending conferences, you know, and going places with spiritual people and wearing the right gemstones. And in fact, I make a point not to do any of that. If I want to be iconoclastic, I might do some stuff just to say, oh, that's what you're doing? Okay, fine, and move on from that. So I might, or I might not, but it's probably better for you to just be seen as just a nobody, because then you don't have to put on airs of being somebody. In other words, slick, professional devotee. You don't have to put on airs. Nobody expects me to be some sort of slick devotee of truth. Nobody expects me to say anything. So I can stay focused on what's really important. Now, let me get back to bodhicitta. It's an interesting term. Bodhi, it means Buddha mind, awakened mind. All mind is awakened mind. There's no mind that's not awakened mind. Everything, mind is inherently awake. That's the only condition there is for mind. And citta is something like, whatever it means in Sanskrit. I'm sure, I lost my slick devotee card right there, didn't I? But that's okay. Let's call it familiarity, or mind stuff, or familiarity with the wakefulness of mind, true nature of mind. Generate familiarity with this. This works. So these top gurus, even though a lot of the people are using those just to try and polish their deadbolt, it still gets through to you. is still helpful. And when you really see them, you realize, wow, I don't really have a clue what they're talking about. Right? I mean, that's when you really see them. And then you think, oh my gosh, I don't want anybody to know it. I really don't know what they're talking about. Because everybody will say, oh yeah, such guru. Yeah, that's what they're saying. I know them. But like we said, I don't really know what they're talking about, actually. But it's fabulous, whatever they're talking about. I really want to know. And this is after your lifetime of effort. You still don't know what they're talking about. So what do you flunked, huh? You flunked. Yeah, I flunked every day of my life. And these professional devotees, they say, no, I got my degree, I got my diploma, this is my attainments and resume. And me, I say, all I've done is flunked every day. But these gurus keep showing up in my life, saying, hey, making offers of friendship to me. Paramasambhava wants to be my friend. He's friended me. It's like, oh my gosh. Why would he do that? I'm an idiot. I've done nothing but flunk out. Nobody thinks I'm anything at all, you know. But he likes me. He likes me. I like him. I like Padmasambhava. I love Padmasambhava. I don't really know exactly what he's talking about or what he's about, but I get the feeling I get is he says one insight settles it all. This is correct. I've experienced this. So I know that he's aware of the experience I had, that one insight settles it all. Indeed it does. This is his kind of catchphrase that is so important. Let's cut right through it and just say, look, one insight settles it all. Just like one key opens the deadbolt. You don't need a million keys to open the deadbolt. One is enough, is it not? These people have a key collection. They got thousands and thousands of keys. And they have them up on the wall, you know, all shiny in cabinets and stuff. Look at my deadbolt key collection. I say, well, I might have you opened it up and gone and say, what? Look at my deadbolt key collection. I think there's one more I can get, you know, like that. But do you have the key that opens the deadbolt? No, I'm still looking for that. Still looking for that one. But look at all these other ones I've got. Really amassed a lot of them. Okay. How about we just set those aside for now and let's focus on what key opens the deadbolt? Oh, well, I'm not good at that. No, nobody's good at that. Who's good at that except the gurus? We're not gurus, right? Well, we are, but we've forgotten that we are. So, pragmatically, that's the situation. So we're not good at looking at this. Yet. And so this generates this feeling here of humility, of wowness, just wow. This is very heavy. Just saying this for me is very powerful. Now, something just occurred to me, is that when you finally get it, open the deadbolt, everybody will be astonished. And they'll say it's not possible, because you're nothing. You're the flunky. I mean, you're the one that's flunked out. We're way beyond you. And you got lucky then. They say, okay, it's luck. This is what they'll say. So they'll put all the spin on it to protect their professional devotee-ness. That's what they'll do. They'll put spin on it. So we just have to accept this. This is what's bothered me for so long. I'm trying to, you know, get into mood of acceptance of this. Is But the professional devotees are not going to accept your enlightenment. They won't. They'll say, you're enlightened, yeah, but it was natural for you. Or, yeah, you just got lucky. Well, it's just an anomaly. Yeah, but there's more, you know. Yeah, but I just don't, you know. They're going to make some excuse, for sure. And they still won't pay attention to you. Did the Sadducees and Pharisees accept Jesus? No, they said, let's crucify him. Most everybody said, let's crucify him. They'll laugh at you. You're like, of course, when you're enlightened, they may not laugh too strongly or longly, because they say, whoa, you know, it's like, maybe I just, and then they'll just kind of scurry away and go back to what they're used to. Or they'll try to argue you down, you know, say, no, I'm the authority. I have the degrees. I'm a professional devotee. I get to choose who gurus. I'm a guru maker. The professional devotees think that they're guru makers. Okay, so they're the ones who make the gurus. They're the ones who decide, anoint the gurus. Okay, you're the one, because you protect us from that off limits. You don't ask us to look at that area that's off limits. Too sensitive. Yeah. So you won't be acclaimed. You will not be acclaimed. Or they'll distort you into some idol that they can acclaim that doesn't threaten their polish, you know, that doesn't say, well, you know, why don't you open the deadbolt? What? What do you mean? I'm doing what I'm supposed to do. I'm shining the deadbolt. It's really shiny. Or they'll flip over the other way of being super ragged. Oh, okay, yeah, I'm not a professional devotee. I'm a professional non-devotee now. Which is just more of the same, isn't it? It's the big companies, corporations doing commercials like, no, we don't make a lot of profits. We just found some guy with a, you know, walking around with a camcorder, and we said, hey, could you make a commercial for us? We got like $50 here. That's all we got. Oh, sure, here. Yeah. Wow, that's a cool commercial. You know, it only cost us $50. That's all we have, folks. So, you know, we got some good deals for you. We're not making any profit. Just like that. So, just talking about this is generating enormous bodhicitta. I can feel it. It's even more important than the insights, you might say, actually. We certainly cannot dispense with this. And this is the difference. The professional devotees, they want the quotes, they want the zingers. Okay. But they don't want this. They don't want this. They don't pay any attention to it. This is the context, the 360-degree context. And when you're enlightened, you'll be ignored, basically. And they'll make excuses for ignoring you. Whatever comes to mind. They might practice a little bit, and then they say, wow, you know, they'll make up some disparaging stories about you, make up stuff that you know, that whatever rationale. Say, no, I can't do this. I want to appear like I'm really spiritually hip in the world, and this isn't doing it for me, and people, you know, and phew, gone. And this is the sad truth. And, you know, ignoring it, it doesn't make it go away. I've never found anything I can do about it. You know, you say, well, what if I'm enlightened? What good does it do if everyone just ignores me? I guess that's a question. That's a good question. And Jesus says that deep down, it registers with them. But superficially, they'll ignore you, yes. But in a more profound way, it's sinking in. They're just kind of saying, wow, I better start thinking about when I transmigrate, let me see if I can be more humble. Let me put myself in a humble position in my next life. So it works in that way. It may not show up in this life. Probably won't. So you have to take a bigger picture. It may show up in the next life. Like for this life here for me, I was put in a situation such that it turned out to be ideal for me. So, generally speaking, people do not want to drop their act in any given life at all. Okay, this is how I see it. It's too embarrassing for them. It's too awkward. It's too shameful. They don't want to lose their professional standing and position. So what they do is they die to save face and transmigrate into another birth, another situation, like they're fresh and new. Nobody knows who they are, where they were in the past life or anything. And then in more humble circumstances, in a situation that enables them to not seem to be very important or need to put on an act, then they can actually get to it, you see. But it's, generally speaking, very few are willing to drop the act in any in a life where they've already started the act. Very few. So usually your impact, your enlightenment, will impact their next life. That's okay, right? Now, if you tell them this, and you then they'll pay attention. This is possible, right? And they'll say, look, you're probably not going to be enlightened this life. You're not willing, you know, it's too tough. But start working on your next life right now. Start spending a little time, maybe in retreats where nobody knows, you know, the awkwardness. But start that wowness now. So you start gearing up for it. You start gearing up for your next life. Because honestly, most of us here in this world will have another life. We'll transmigrate to save face. We'll transmigrate. Almost all of us here will transmigrate. With a few exceptions, I will not transmigrate anymore. But we can say all of us will transmigrate, and when we make such a generalized statement, we understand that there'll a few exceptions here and there. Okay, that's fine. So all of us will transmigrate. So we have to start focusing on our next life. As far as gearing up, like if you're going to climb Mount Everest, guess what? You better start gearing up. So you say, maybe I better start working on this little habit, and maybe I better start working on this little habit. And you start acquiring these little habits, and you start working on them. So when you transmigrate into another body, you don't go into a body, but you identify with another body. You believe that that body's necessary. It needs to do something. The body needs to do something, needs to feel something. This is delusion. But you have these new habits, these good habits, along with the old bad habits. Yeah, professional devoteeism. But you have these new habits. And so gradually they start gaining momentum, and the old habits start losing momentum. This is what, looking back in my life, this is exactly what has happened. So set yourself up for your next life. So this is, don't beat yourself up. Say, well, I'm not going to be enlightened this life. I'm a failure. No. It's understood. It's you have to hit the ground running in your life. I hit the ground running from the very get-go. Even before I identified with this body, I was setting up success, final success here. So I hit the ground running. I was aware of the gurus in the wherever you transmigrate after you drop this body, some sort of realm. I was aware of the gurus, the teachers. I knew they were going to help me out, and so I already knew all this coming into this realm. transmigrating into this realm. So I hit the ground running right off the bat. I was super keen about it all, super keen, and super confident. I said, I'm going to succeed. There's no question about it. People said, what are you talking about? You know, well, let us help you. You're the professional devotee. I said, oh, great, let us help you. Yeah, we know success. And I said, no, you don't. And they got really upset about that. I said, you're the ones who caused me to fail, actually. I said, what are you talking about? We're very knowledgeable about spiritual things. He said, but you're not knowledgeable about the core. You're ignorant of the core. What do you do? How dare you call us ignorant? You're just a little child, you know. So they didn't like that. So it's better to just be quietly go about your business here. Don't seek for fame and fortune. Just quietly go about your business and stay confident that, yeah, I prepared for this life. This is the final transmigration. I will not no longer be transmigrating through realms. I like this term much better than death, et cetera, et cetera. I'll no longer be transmigrating through realms. I can appear in any realm I want to, but I won't be transmigrating through realms at all. There's no face I need to save. So if we can accept this, then this tilts things in a different direction, doesn't it? Then it's possible that you won't be ignored if you take this approach. Nobody likes to hear that they're going to transmigrate, but in the back of their mind, they realize that they will. It will be, maybe I study the Tibetan Book of the Dead, I'll be able to be free, and you know. But so it's a real tough thing to realize I'm going to be coming back, and maybe, you know, I'm not, but you are, like, because then they realize who's the real professional, you know. It's the one that is finished with transmigration. So it's a tough, bitter pill to swallow, but as you at some point you might be able to swallow that pill. Okay, this is what I have hope for all of you. Not, you know, and again, some of you may be exceptions to that. I always, when we speak in generalities, because this is how words and concepts work. So if you're an exception and you're going to be free of transmigration, are already free, then of course it doesn't include you, but we just use all of you. You know, maybe you can, you know, maybe you're working on accepting this, swallowing this bitter pill. Now, for me, I'm very aware of transmigration, and so I already swallowed that bitter pill back in 1978. But what it was for me was, I knew if I don't succeed this lifetime, I will continue to transmigrate. It doesn't matter how many gurus I know or what my spiritual knowledge is, I will continue to transmigrate. And for me, that's completely unacceptable. So, but I can see how it's possible that you could accept it. It's possible to be for some. I'm putting myself in your shoes. I can see. Yeah, it's a bitter pill, but you can accept it. One more. But that's it. You can do that. But you have to be really adamant about that and start generating this bodhicitta, because this really works. Just be totally focused on the top dogs, which is what I was, came coming to this world so focused. I say, where are the top dogs? Where are they? I gotta find them. I finally found them. It's really difficult. Because the professional devotees, they tend to say, well, you know, over here, you know, because they don't wanna get too close to the top dogs. Top dogs might say, hey, look, you don't really know anything that you need to know. You don't have the key to the deadbolt yet. You got a key collection. Got a key collection. That's not where it's at. Now, some will say, no, transmigration, no, no, no. If I just deny it, it won't happen. Not so, not so. Because the ultimate realization is I don't need to do anything at all with anybody at all. There's nothing the body needs to do. There's nothing anybody needs to do. It doesn't matter if I have a trillion bodies, not one of them, not one of them needs to do anything at all. I need do nothing to be what I already am. Nothing at all has to happen. The body, I don't have to experience any feelings the body has or sensations the body has. None of that. Nothing whatsoever. The body's completely useless to me. Completely. A trillion bodies are all equally useless to me. Totally useless. Other than simply communicating the fact that they're useless. And anybody can do that. Doesn't matter what the body is or whatever. I have no need for a body, no intrinsic need for any body or any form, time, space, process, form, none of that. Nothing needs to happen. Nothing needs to happen at all. I'm already wakefulness itself. So until we have this realization, we will continue to transmigrate because we think we need to do something with the body and we can't quite figure out what it is. And so we keep going to teachers and gurus and spiritual devotees and what do I need to do with my body? I don't know how do I succeed? The answer is we don't need to do anything with it. Which is why Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma, if nobody asked her for spiritual advice and encouragement, her body would just go into a frozen death state. Be dead. There'd be no discernible pulse, breath, no sign of life in the body at all. And yet it would be kind of frozen, so it wouldn't like decompose. It just stayed there. And then when they finally said, okay, we're okay. We want your advice. And then they chant and sing spiritual songs and prayers and everything, and gradually the body would revive. And she says, look, I told you that the body, I have no need for the body to do anything. There's nothing, the body doesn't need to do anything at all. Nothing at all. I'm only appearing here as a body so that you have a communication device that you feel comfortable, you know, relating to. Other than that, that's it. And so she literally, this is what happened many times. So they were always kind of nervous about her. Rightfully so. The looks on their faces, you know, Gupriya, Devi, Didi, her attendant, always had this frown on her face, you know, like, you know, don't any of you guys, you know, mess it up because she's gonna drop dead, you know, at any moment. I've seen it many times, you know. And she's, I gotta keep her here. How do I keep her here, you know? poor Gurupriya Devi. Oh my gosh. What a tough role that was. Wow. Take your hats off to her. That was her chief attendant, you know, just said, you guys don't know. I mean, she doesn't care about her body at all. The body is nothing to her. And so you guys got to toe the mark, you know. If you do something that she loses interest, you're not asking for help, she's going to drop dead again, you know. So, good Lord. So she's very strict and fierce and you're frightened, you know. Come on. She should have called upon me, Gupriya. You know, I would have called upon her help. Come on, I'm calling upon her right now. But in India, they were able to keep her busy for, you know, 86 years. So here in the West, she dropped dead like that. Ha ha ha. spiritual devotees, this professional devotees would say, "Yeah, okay, we got it. Okay, we got it, right?" And poof, she dropped dead. Then they'd say, "Oh, what do we do? Oh my gosh, we got a corpse here. You know, let's slink out of the room. Shh, don't tell anybody. Okay, what do we do? Oh my gosh, what happened?" And then that would completely blow their professional devotee cover. I mean, this guru, they're with the guru, and the guru just drops dead. They start immediately planning. Okay, what kind of building are we going to house them in, and what's the funeral ceremony, and what kind of rites and rituals will we have, and how many hospitals can we build off of this, and get how many pilgrims we can. They're already thinking, but we got the dead guru in the body in the room. How about start generating bodhicitta and determination and pledge, I want you to help set me up for my next life. So I want you to come back. I want you to come back here. Let's work at it. This, the guru revives. The guru revives when you do that. But here, I got a feeling the world right now is, all that would happen is we'd have a whole bunch of mausoleums for dead gurus. I'd say, look, my sister, I'm no good at building mausoleums, so you can't die. I couldn't do anything for you if you're dead, actually. I'm no good with the dead at all. I'm not. I don't know what to do with the dead. So, for my sake, don't die. I wouldn't know what to do with you. Just turn into light, okay? That's what I want you to do. If you gotta leave, then just turn into light. So you might be thinking, well, I don't quite get this. Well, yeah. That's the wow feeling. But you're trying, right? And many are not trying. Most are not trying. Almost all are not trying. So if you're trying, that means you're setting yourself up either for this life or the next one to be your last transmigration. How cool is that? And you might say, well, I don't know what I'd do. Well, you will find out as you get closer. I still don't know exactly, but I'm getting closer. The more you practice this full stop in the wow, the closer you're getting. To being the guru. See, the goal is not to be professional devotees, the goal is to be the guru. So if you're not truly liberated from any notion that you do need to do anything with the body at all, that the body has any use for you at all, other than, of course, just since you have one, using it to communicate, but until you're totally, truly liberated from this, you will transmigrate. What else could you do? You'll still think that there's a need for a body to do something. So of course you'll animate a body and have it do stuff and have it feel stuff. There's no need for the body to feel anything. Nothing whatsoever. There's no need for the body to do anything. Nothing whatsoever. So when Rama Maharshi told me you're going to be very helpful down the road, I said, what? But I don't see. Nobody's going to pay any attention, Rama. And he said, no, you're going to be very, very helpful. So what he's talking about is helping generate the bodhicitta for your next life as you transmigrate, that it'll probably show up in life, the next life or the next one, that kind of thing. It'll show up down the road. That's what he's talking about. But that doesn't mean we can't get it going now. Yeah, of course we get it going. But, you know, you may not reach ultimate liberation. You may not be liberated from transmigration yet. So you might have to, you know, choose to save face and die, drop this body, pick up another one in some realm, either this world or some other realm, you know, countless realms you can, you find yourself some other realm, dream of bodies and bodies doing things and stuff happening and all this. But you'll have this confidence. You'll have this feeling. You say, you have some, you know, it's getting into you like, hey, I can just wow my life instead of work on the polish, just wow my life. And that's okay. That's what works. That's what works. See, when you do this, you don't have much energy left over to be a professional devotee. Yeah, this is too stressful. It's very stressful. Great strain. I feel a very strong wow about all of this. Now, the truth is that spirit can be identifying with several bodies simultaneously in different parts of the world. I know, you know, I was someone this last life I had, but I could have had another life at the same time. Or many different lives, bodies, identifying with different bodies. It's possible, isn't it? Yeah, it sure is. But in any case, it's all the same idea that we believe bodies need to do something. They need to find the self. realize the self. The bodies need to know. There's nothing that realizes the self. There's no act of realization at all. There's no act of realization. This is something Ram Maharshi says. There's no act of realization at all. There's no action of realization whatsoever. Very, very great. Just let this. You hear what they say, and for me, it. I just take it in, and I know down the road, it's going to. I say aha. I may not. I have a aha now, and then it kind of. I get kind of nervous about it, and then it fades a little. But I know down the road, as I take it in and keep it. I get used to it. Like if you put on a necklace or something, you know, you're wearing it every day, guess what? After a while, you get used to it. When you first put it on, you say, what is this? After a couple months, you're used to it. So these insights are just like, they're like necklaces. Just put on these necklaces. Put on these ornaments, the bangles or something, bracelets. Put on these hats, I don't know. And you just get used to them. You get used to it. So this morning I had this very, very great recognition of all of this. The body need not do anything. I don't need to do anything. Nothing needs to happen at all. So this is where I'm at. I was able to look at it all from this perspective, from this angle. So I'm able to look at it from this angle and say, wow. One insight settles it all. I don't need to do anything. Doesn't that settle it all? It does, right? If you realize you don't need to do anything whatsoever, never and never have had to do anything, doesn't that settle it all? All regrets? Yeah, it does. But doesn't that settle it all? As we look at it. We don't have to say it does or it doesn't. We just look at it. You know, that's better, just to look at it. If I realize there's nothing I need to do, there's nothing I ever needed to do to be what I am. I've always been what I am, perfectly so. I haven't had to generate anything in order to be what I am. So I never had to do anything at all. Doesn't that dissolve all regrets, all awkwardness, clumsiness? We look back and say, well, I wish I had done that differently. Yeah, we never had to do anything. So there's no question of, I wish I had done this differently. So it dissolves all regrets. This is what I experienced. I experienced all regrets vanishing simultaneously. Just one little insight settled it all. And that was, I don't need to do anything. There's nothing I need to do. Nothing needs to happen. I don't need to do anything. I don't have to have anything happen to me either. So this, you know, this is very heavy territory, isn't it? So how do we keep our polisher full stop in the wow? We just sit quietly as the wow is just, you know, like a Super Bowl bouncing around. Bing, 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 bing. I used to love Super Bowls. You don't see them as much anymore, but back in the day, you know, they were everywhere, and I just loved playing with those Super Bowls because they were just so bouncy, just wham, and just whoa, they go back up, then wham, wham. You'd throw them and bounce off walls and everything. I was a Super Bowl. I loved to play with those. I was a very playful kid, especially with anything you can bounce and throw, baseball, with a ball, basketball, anything. It bounces around. It's a lot of fun. This is how the Super Bowl is bouncing around. Boom, 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 boom. Wow. Boom, 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 boom. Oh, just sit quietly. Don't even follow. Imagine you're in like a racquetball court or something, a closed room, a cubicle. It's all closed, and someone throws this ball, really bouncy ball, bing, 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 just bouncing all over the place. Okay, so imagine you're sitting, just sit in the middle of the floor, look straight ahead, pay no attention to where the ball is bouncing, what wall it's hitting now, what's trajectory or anything. This is a great practice. And you just realize, yeah, there's a ball bouncing all over the place. Okay, fine. But I'm not going to, that's as far as I'm going to go with it. And I'm not concentrating on this wall. I'm not trying to distract myself and deny there's a ball bouncing around. I honor the ball bouncing around. I said, yeah, that's happening, because that's my wow. I just refuse to follow it, measure it, analyze it, graph it, represent it, you know, do anything about it. I'm not doing anything about it. I'm just sitting quietly. That's all I'm doing. I'm not even doing anything about that either. I'm not quantifying that, sitting quietly. I'm just not quantifying. I'm just sort of this inert, neutral, inert, doing nothingness, but aware that, you know, I just threw this super ball, it's bouncing around the room. Okay. This is the practice that succeeds. It frees you from transmigration. Because within, you're reacting. I'm reacting within now. Like a super ball is bouncing all over within. Okay, but I'm not really focused on the reaction. I'm aware it's there, vaguely. You know, it's like a pot of water, a pot of water's boiling. You got the lid on. You know, you're aware it's boiling, but it's not. You put it on the back burner and let it simmer. It's boiling, okay. But you're not peeking in the pot. How much is it boiling? How much is it boiling? Yeah, it's boiling. That's enough. I reach boiling. You know, it's boiling. It's boiling. Let it boil. Let it reduce. So if you're a cook, you could use cooking analogies, right? Whatever your thing is, you can use analogies from what your thing is. And just let it reduce. Right? I mean, can you force something to reduce? No, just keep the flame on. And just let it simmer and let it reduce. Maybe you stir it a little bit, but, you know, just let it reduce. And you just go about, you know, setting the table or something. But don't. Watch, pot never boils. You know, let it reduce. Let the intensity reduce here. This is evaporating our continuity fear. We're reducing into a nice gravy here, nice sauce. I don't cook it anymore because I just blend, you know, smoothies, fruit drinks, and smoothies. Just I don't really eat much. I eat here and there. I prepare food for other people and I'll take a little bit of here and a little bit of here, you know. So, I mean, I have mac and cheese sometimes. You know, that's my, if I want to really go off my diet, you know, nice mac and cheese. I'll throw some extra cheese on it, put some feta cheese in it, put some Tabasco seasonings. I like the green Tabasco sauce and the smoky Tabasco sauce. They're not as hot. And I'll put some of the hot stuff. And, you know, throw a few things in there and eat that. So I don't have a diet per se. I just am, you know, frugal with what I eat, and if I need to eat something, I'll eat it. But if I don't, if I can just avoid eating at all, that's fine. That's even better. I don't know what I'll have today. I don't know. I'm thinking I'll probably have some papaya. I'll throw that in there, and what else? I don't know, some apples. I don't know, pineapple, some pineapple chunks, papaya. I had some Greek yogurt with walnuts and pecans this morning. That was my breakfast. So I did eat. I just have you get these little cups of yogurt at the market, mix in the nuts, and in 2 minutes you're finished, and that's it. Get to work taping here. So this wow I'm feeling is really a burn. It's really burning my core. If you talk about core workouts, this is burning the core. So you can do spiritual core workouts. And we know that most of us avoid the real intense core workouts. Especially those who are, you know, I mean, if you're a 100-pound yoga girl, it's easy to do the core thing, and they can specialize in that. But for most of us, in working out, it's easier to jog or bench press. But the core workout, oh man! I mean, I'm thinking right now about I got to do some core today. Oh gosh, I don't know. It's not bad, but we just don't do it. So the same thing with spiritual core workout. We don't do it. We tend to do that last. We professional devotees, they're working on their biceps. That's easy, right? Biceps, just do curls and this and this and pump it up. But they may not do the real tough stuff, like really working on the legs. Jogging doesn't really work on the legs that much. I mean, it's a good workout. It's a good fitness thing to do, but it has some benefits. So if you're jogging, then it's fine, jog. But try jogging upstairs. And then jog upstairs sideways, crossing your legs over, doon, doon, like this. Doon, doon. I can't do it backwards. It's too awkward to try to go upstairs backwards. But I guess you could. I haven't tried hopping yet. I'll have to try that. See if I can hop 2 feet at a time, or 1 feet at a t 1 foot at a time. I don't know if I can do it 1 foot at a time. It might be a little too difficult. But probably 2 feet at a time. I can. Let's see if I can hop up stairs 2 feet at a time. Wow, haven't tried that. I for some reason, it's like that spiritual practice. We don't try it because we think like, I'll be terrible at it, right? So we don't try it. So when nobody's looking, I'm gonna try it. Yeah. I'll practice it here on a step, just one step. I'll try to see if I can do one-legged hop up and how much I can do that. Because you really want this springiness in your leg. You want the springiness. You want the hops, the spring. Because that involves your whole body, actually. Like a cat, a cat, where is a cat strong? What, it's like the paws are strong, cats doing paw workouts. And we look at a cat and say, where's the cat's strength? And yet they're so agile and quick and seem to, because their whole body is strong. It all works together. It's all coordinated. They got the hops, don't they, the cats? Something startles them, boom, like a spring up in the air, like like that. Instantly, they just have the hops. So we can talk about food and workout, those things, 360 degrees as the burn is there, right? As it's simmering, as it's boiling, right, on the back burner. Turn down the flame a little bit and just let it boil. Let the wow boil. If this is your last transmigration, then the gurus will contact you for sure, and you'll start working with them, because that what they're all about is the big picture of they see that you may have another, you may keep transmigrating for a while, but they're gradually reeling you in, so one of these transmigrations will be your last. So they're very aware of that, and they need to get you into that mode of realization of that's how it really goes. It's humbling. Everybody wants to be acclaimed in this life, right? They don't say, well, the next one. But I'll tell you one thing. You can be acclaimed in one life, and the next one, nobody will know you, even know your name. This is what happened with me. Yeah, you talk about difficulty. Try that one. It's way better to not be acclaimed, so you don't, so it's easier to just, melt into the background and just do your spiritual work. But if you really have high acclaim in one life, then you come, you expect that to continue. Those are your habits. Your whole life is that way. Your reactions are that way. You just expect everybody knows who you are. And, you know, it's not such an ego trip. It's just your habits. This is what you're used to. And when none of that's happening, it's like total shock. So what the hell's wrong? What happened? Yeah. Nobody knows who you are. Because they don't want to admit that they've transmigrated. Nobody wants to admit they've transmigrated. So I have no idea who you are. So what are you talking about? You were there too. You know who I am. No, you're crazy. They're just saving face. They said, no, I'm not. They're saving face by refusing to admit that they're saving face by transmigrating. They said, no, I got to get another body. I don't want to appear to be awkward, so I'll drop this body, and then I'll appear in another place. Nobody knows that I dropped the body before, right? No, I'm just freshly minted, never saving face, so that they refuse to admit. A lot of times I see people, I know, I have a pretty good idea. I say, I know you in a past life, you must have been this and this, and I can just see it. But you say it to them, oh, no. I didn't have a previous life. What are you talking about? But they're really saying, no, this life here is where I get the acclaim for being a professional devotee, and that's it. And then they have to slink off, transmigrate into another place where nobody knows them, and nobody is willing to admit that they're just transmigrating. And they say, okay, nobody knows that I really didn't make it. I was just a professional devotee and I really didn't make it. Nobody knows that. Okay, I save face. You have to drop that. I mean, so a culture that's only interested in saving face, which is what we have, the culture we have now, this is what's showing up in politics. Very much so. The mood in this world is to save face, and I'm totally against that. You know, that's detrimental. So politically, I'm a maverick. I'm iconoclastic, okay? Because I really say it's not good for any of us to concentrate just on saving face, which is what I call what the liberals are doing. That mindset is a mindset of trying to deny what's really going on. Saving face. It's a saving face mindset. That's why they're so sensitive to anyone pointing out that that their professional devotee-ness is anything other than everything, you know, like they want to believe they're doing the right thing with their body, when in fact that very belief is exactly the wrong thing. They're very sensitive about that. So what's happening in the United States is the conservative party, and Trump in particular, is just pointing out the foibles of the liberals, and they can't stand that. They just hate it. They loathe it. They fear it. Like I say, there's nothing more than I fear Trump, nothing more than I fear somebody pointing out that I'm just a professional devotee, and I transmigrated here, and I'll transmigrate somewhere else. There's nothing I fear more than that. We got to legislate against that. So liberals are like legislating against truth. They don't want any of that stuff. No. You know, and that's why Trump freaks them out, because he'll just say, you know, he doesn't have that fear thing in his mind so much. And they don't want, they can't, they're terrified of that. He might, you know, say something that I don't want to hear. No. So they're trying to produce a cult where nobody says anything that someone else doesn't want to hear. But don't spiritual teachers constantly say stuff we don't want to hear, right? Isn't that what they do? Isn't that Rama Maharshi? Yes, it is. God bless you, Rama Maharshi, my brother, for being willing to say everything you said. Super iconoclastic. If you just listen, just, oh my God, are you kidding? Wow, thank you. So if I support anyone, I would support Trump, I would say, because in the long run, it's way more beneficial to start facing up to your insecurities, to your facade, and wowing it, you know. Instead of freaking out, all these liberals are freaking out. Why don't they just start wowing it their lives? You know, just start wowing it and set yourself up for your next life. So don't. Who cares what the messenger, you know, is? He's, you know, it's somebody who's saying all this stuff that you don't want to hear. That's great. They're like your best friend. Be best friends. Friend him. All you liberals, go to, I don't know, go to Trump. What was it? Facebook and friend him. Now I'm not going to literally support this one. I'm supporting this outreach here. But you never know what I'll do. I'm iconoclastic. I don't even know what I'll do. But if you really want to blow your mind, okay, if you know, most people, spiritual people, are liberals because they're professional devotees, which is a cult of don't say anything that startles me, so I lose my facade. And they all agree, yeah, I got a facade. You got a facade? Yeah, I got a facade. You got a facade? Good, good. Got it, get it, got it, good, great. We got facades. And let's not say anything. Let's not rock the boat. Let's make sure we got the quotes here and everything. Okay, great, we got it. Don't say anything that rocks the boat. Don't say anything. Oh, thank you. You didn't rock my boat. Thank you. You didn't. Oh, That's a cult. It's a cult. The liberals are a cult, actually. So you got to start getting out of that cult. Really. So if you really want to do something that'll blow your mind, okay. And I probably 99% of the spiritual people on Facebook and in the world are liberals. I don't know if there's anything or not, actually. I'd lose all my friends. I'm going to put some Trump thing up there and I'll lose all my friends. That's okay. I might do it. I don't know. I might do it. Just to, you know, blow their minds and say, look, you got to start blowing your mind. And just go like Trump. Just say, I like it. Why? Because this is helping me get out of this cult. And this, I need this sort of rough treatment now. I'm not, you know, this is helpful for many because, like, you can also hate him too. So it's like I have a love-hate thing, you know, with Trump. You can have a love-hate thing. But here's somebody that's saying what I don't want to hear. Hold up a mirror to me. I don't want to see that. I don't want to see it. You know what? Just start, blow your own mind, knock yourself out today. But we're you can say, "Oh, Clarity Ross said, you know, to give this a try," and say, "Okay, that's okay, that's okay," because you feel okay. The gurus, you know, are behind. Are oh, they're not gonna, you know. Leave me, you see, because if I say this, I've got all these friendships with the gurus. And the saints, they're my friends, they're my brothers and sisters. If I felt they were going to leave me because of doing this, you know, I wouldn't be saying it, right? I wouldn't be saying it. And so you got to realize that the gurus are not liberals, okay? They're not here to protect your facade of being a professional devotee. They're not saying, "Oh, what a great professional devotee. That's great. That's all you need." They're not conservatives either, but they're pragmatists. They're pragmatists. So they want to blow your mind. They want you to start realizing I can survive this. So if you really want to do something today that'll transform your life, go and like Trump on his Facebook page or on his website or something, or post a picture and say, "Donald, I love you." And then just sit here in the wow. Just sit in the wow of that, and this will be such a strong wow. And prove to yourself that you can sit in the wow. And it's okay. The sun is still shining. The gurus haven't abandoned you. I haven't abandoned you, and then therefore the gurus have not abandoned you, right? They're not. When a guru friends you, they're not going to abandon you. Longchenpa said he'll never abandon me. Pledged it. There's nothing I can do. There's nothing I can do that's going to have Longchenpa abandon me. He says, I'm going to see to it, okay, that you are going to be liberated from transmigration. That's my pledge. So, he's not. Right? So, what's important is you start feeling this wow, and that's a great one. I mean, Trump is a godsend for liberals. You know that? Maybe not so much for conservatives. He's here more for the liberals. He's given you an opportunity to wow, blow your mind, to wow it. Go out, vote for him. If you really want to wow yourself, go vote for him. I don't vote because it's not it wouldn't be appropriate in my role to be voting, actually. It's my final life, final transmigration, so I'll let you guys decide, you know, how you want to shape your transmigrations, etc. Because you're the ones who are going to be living it, okay? So this is just how I feel about it. You're the ones who are going to have to put up with the consequences. I won't have to. I won't have to put up with any consequences. But, so you better start feeling this wow. You might be saying, what's this wow? I don't understand what you're talking about. Well, just go like Trump and then feel the wow. Wow, I'm going to lose all my friends. I have like, you know, 6,000 friends on Facebook. And you know what? If you say, hey, today I went and liked Trump website and I posted a picture saying, Donald, I love you. Guess what? You wake up in the next day and all your friends are gone. So were they your real friends or were they just your cult buddies? Is the question. Your facade buddies. Now I remember when I finally started doing that, but I was the opposite. I was a liberal. I was the same way. I was a liberal and I started not hating on conservatives like Ronald Reagan. And I was like, it just blew my mind. Blew my mind. I said, is this possible? I'm going to die, right? I'm sure I'm going to die. I didn't curse Ronald Reagan. I mean, liberals just are haters from the soles of their feet to the hairs on the top of their head. They're just haters. And they just hate conservatives. And I stopped hating on the conservatives. And I thought, I'm going to die. Obviously, I'm going to die, right? Because liberals think that if they don't hate on conservatives, they're going to die. Plain and simple. We'll all be nuked. We'll all be nuked. You know. So just try not hating. And so I did that. It took many, many years and years and years. But boy, did I blow my mind. I said, I didn't die. What happened? I didn't know what. What? And if you're a conservative, you can go like Hillary. That'll blow your mind too. I might do that. I don't know. Yeah, I feel like I'm going to die. No, I could do that. I like her. I like everyone. But pragmatically, we've got to be pragmatic also. In terms of, you know, setting you up and you're transmigrating so that you can really drop the facade of and be willing to hear what's uncomfortable for you. And Hillary's all about, you know, let's make sure we all don't make each other feel uncomfortable. I always make people feel uncomfortable so they don't want to be around me. But, you know, that's a true friend that makes you feel uncomfortable in a certain way. That's a true friend. They're bringing up, hey, you know, let's drop the facade here. There's a facade at work here, huh? And, you know, I can jest with people and say, do it, but they get very upset. This is what I found out. When you're in a cult, you get a facade cult, a professional devotee, it's a facade cult. You get really mad if somebody presses you on this. Really, really bad. But I just keep pressing, you know, keep pressing. Come on, why don't you try it? Are you crazy? I'm going to die. You're asking me to die. I mean, most liberals, I guarantee you, if they went to Donald Trump's Facebook page and liked his page and started following it, or you know, liked, you know, I like this, they literally think that God will condemn them for this and they will go to hell and they're going to die and they're evil, wicked people and they're not going to... Their next transmigration will be in hell, even though they don't believe in God. They believe in hell. And they believe in death. So they're going to die for this. Literally, they feel you're asking them to be annihilated. Literally. This is why they get so angry. But how spiritual are they if this is their reaction? They don't. There's a whole area in the psyche that's walled off. They did not let the light in. Or they've not let the light out. See, that shines too with light. They have not done that. They've been busy with the superficial polishing the deadbolt. So, you know, so if you do that, they'll condemn you. They'll condemn you. Because they think that you're part of the cult. I'm not part of a liberal cult, folks. I used to be, so I know it through and through and through and through and through, and I've done what you need to do, what most of you need to do. Not all of you here are liberals, so I know that. At least I think so. But some might be, which is fine, because what we're talking about transcends all this, isn't it? It's how to practice in the right way, the wow, and to get free of transmigration. And all this political figures, all this nonsense, is just, you just use it in the right way. See, use it as an expedient. This is how I see it. Trump's a great expedient for your spiritual path. He really is. He really is. You can make more progress if you try to embrace Trump and feel the shock of that. You will make more progress than going to see a guru, probably. I mean, seriously. Seriously. Instead of going to see Muji, you know, go like Donald Trump on Facebook, okay? That will really blow your mind. Because then you say, oh my God, you find out you don't die. And you're not rejected. The guru doesn't reject you. God doesn't reject you. The Holy Spirit doesn't reject you. Say, what happened? And then your whole facade starts to realize, oh my God, it's just a facade. But I can wow it. I can wow this. And your whole life has changed from that. Your life will change more by doing that than going to see Muji and Rishikesh, okay? Not that wouldn't be helpful. I believe it would be helpful to go see Muji and Rishikesh also. But I think as far as pragmatically goes, liking Donald Trump would be even more powerful for you, even more powerful. Be more of a challenge, but you would speed things up immeasurably by doing that, actually. They're going to start a little website, Liberals for Trump, you know, Facebook page, Liberals for Trump, Liberals who love Trump. I might do it, right? But nobody would show up. No, are you kidding me? Very few leave the liberal cult. I was one of the few fortunate ones. It was extremely difficult. Wow, what a cult that is. It's a world cult now. I mean, it's spread throughout the world. Strength in numbers. But boy, would I get a frosty reception from that. But, you know, who are you kicking? Who are you giving a frosty reception to? You don't know. You see, you don't even know. You just assume, oh, it's an idiot or something. Doesn't recognize my facade for what it is, my key collection. It doesn't respect my key collection. Well, I respect it, sure, but it doesn't work. It doesn't do any good. And don't, you know, transmigration is a bummer, okay? It really is a bummer. Big time. And at some point, you'll recognize that. You might as well get on it now. So you got this great opportunity. I don't know if I have the guts to do this, actually. If the Holy Spirit asks me to, I will. As I would be like freaking out, you know. Jesus for Trump. Oh my God. They just think I'm being insolent. But no. So you have to understand, I'm not being insolent at all. There's total wisdom, bodhicitta wisdom, behind all of this. Now, you don't have to vote for Trump. You can still do your liberal thing. But use Trump as a spiritual expedient. Don't hate on him. Love him. Because he's pointing out to the liberals, look, you're knuckleheads. Which is true, right? It's a facade. It's a facade cult. It's doubling down on ignorance. And yeah, my education taught me everything I needed to know. That's a liberal, yeah. But I'm continuing it a little bit in some night classes or whatever. I'm continuing my education, yeah. As Ramaharji says, education is learned ignorance. What education does, it tells you it's okay to wall off that inner part. That everybody does that. That's fine. That's great. So we need to do that, because that part of you, that part, you know, that needs to be the unknown. We don't need to know about that. And just polish the deadbolt. You know, polish the deadbolt's where it's at. This is what it is. So the more education you have, the more liberal you tend to become, because you get into this cult of, hey, polishing the deadbolt's where it's at. This is what happens. And of course, the liberals are very proud of their education and say everybody who's not a liberal must be some kind of hillbilly redneck. Come on. Must listen to Johnny Cash. Yeah, I listen to Johnny Cash. Nothing wrong with Johnny Cash. Hello, my name is Johnny Cash. Yeah, I listen to classic country. Oh my God, you see? If you went to university, you wouldn't do that. Well, if I went to a university, I would have missed out on that. I would have missed out on Jesus too, actually, and missed out on a lot of stuff. Right, the Dharma kings. Missed out on the wow practice. I would have missed out. I would have kept transmigrating. Oh yeah, evolving my potential, my physical human potential. I missed out on that. Gee. How terrible. I need to do nothing. That's what Jesus says. This is when you get this, from this perspective. He says, then you know. That's it. You're not going to transmigrate anymore. When you're able to look at it from this perspective, and I did it this morning. Jesus says, okay, now be aware that you are now accepting your freedom. You're accepting your freedom. Just be aware of that. So I'm aware of that. I'm aware of that. At some point, those who are identifying as liberals might thank me, maybe the next life. You'll thank me in the next life, not this one. Say, wow, it's the best thing I ever did. Just blew my mind. I blew my mind, which as a liberal, they never really blow their minds. They use drugs and sex, drugs, rock and roll to blow their minds. But they never really blow their minds. They never really blow their facade. Okay? Except this will blow your mind. It will blow your facade. And at some point, you'll say, wow, that's the best thing I ever did. Completely flip my script. Just, I was never the same after that. Never the same. I just, I said, oh yeah, I need to get the key to that deadbolt. And then my collection really doesn't matter. My collection of keys that don't work doesn't really matter. You know, we say, look at all these keys. I really tried hard. Jesus, I really tried hard. I've got, this is the evidence. Look, all these keys, they didn't work. I really tried hard. Now, can I die? And save face and don't tell anybody that I transmigrated. I had this other life and I didn't quite make it. Don't, could he just not say anything about that, Jesus? Jesus, well, I won't, stress it too much, but, it is true, right? At least you can, could you consider this? Yeah, but don't tell anybody. My key collection was just worthless to me. Don't tell anybody. I could do a lot of things that people get very upset about. A picture of Sri Sri Ananda, my ma, our beloved sister, was saying, Trump, you know. I would be burned in effigy. I would be burned in effigy. Seriously, I would be burned in effigy. This is... So are these spiritual aspirants or occultists? Is the question, right? Do you really want to be a cultist? Cult of ignorance. The cult of avoidance. Or do you want to be a true devil, a true aspirant? You know, truly aspire. Truly aspire. A true devotee, not a professional cult devotee, but a true devotee. More than that, do you want to realize your house is on fire? Or do you want to, just burn down with the house? I don't know. I'll be anathema on Facebook. I'll be an absolute anathema. But nobody's looking at my posts anyway. So, you know, what the hey? And, you know, if a woman does that, it'll blow her mind even more. Because the way we've got nature set up, it favors women so extremely because they have produced bodies that keep this whole body thing going, like I need the body to do something. So nature, we have to favor women, and they're greatly favored here. It makes it very tough on them because they say, why should I give up my advantage? I have this advantage. Why don't we just turn into a cult? So, but if a woman could do that, and that'll really blow her mind, really blow your mind if you're a woman, it will just absolutely change your life. There's some women that could do that. You know, I see there's some that are almost there. But they still think they're going to die if they do that. They'll lose their advantage. They'll die. Everything will go terrible. Well, I'll tell you what. It's not terrible when the guru, the Dharma kings, contact you. That is not terrible at all. They'll show up. The Holy Spirit will show up and say, hey, don't worry. The cult leaders are no longer advising you. They're frowning on you. That's okay. I'm here. I'll advise you now. The ego's no longer advising you? No problem. I'll advise you perfectly until you're truly free of transmigration. Now, you don't have to tell anybody, but within you, you'll realize, wow, I did something awesome. I did something awesome today. I faced my fears, you know, that God would abandon me if I like Trump. He's the boogeyman. He's the perfect boogeyman. He's the perfect boogeyman for everybody. He's a wonderful boogeyman. Thank God for Trump. He's a wonderful boogeyman. He gives us this opportunity. See, Trump doesn't bother me at all. One way or the other, you know, if he's an idiot, he's an idiot. Yeah. It doesn't bother me if he's an idiot. He doesn't scare me at all. Clinton doesn't really scare me either. Although I know what she would do is vastly worse than what Trump would do, but it doesn't really scare me, no. I could hang out with her, Hills, you know, hanging out with Hills. Could even hang out with Barry O. B.O. But Bo, hang out with Bo, little Bo Peep. That's okay, it's all good. But I don't have this fear and loathing. It just doesn't exist. Because I know the truth. I'm on the truth that nothing needs to happen for any of us. Nothing that's happening has anything to do with what we are, and we don't have any need for it whatsoever. Zero. Zero. Everything in existence in this universe, nothing has anything to do with need. We don't need any of it to happen in one way or the other. Zero need. The mind is inherently wakeful. Everything in reality is inherently as it is. It doesn't need to do anything to be what it is, to validate what it is, so to speak. The only validation is our freedom, is experiencing our freedom. But that's just natural. There's nothing else to do but do that, actually. So that's effortless, too. Liberals for Trump. Holy cow. It's like Jews for Jesus. Of course, most of the early Christians were Jews, so that's not such a strange thing to say. No greater step can anyone take than a liberal to embrace Trump. Jesus said, no greater love has one that lays his life down for a brother. Well, no greater spiritual advancement could happen for a liberal to like Trump. This was you're leaving the cult. You're leaving the cult. How great is that? Because you're never going to get there as long as you stay in this cult. It's just supporting transmigration is all it is doing, actually. And just candy coating transmigration is all that's happening. That's all that's happening. That has nothing to do with the purpose of the gurus, the Dharma kings. Nothing to do with it whatsoever. As Ramaharsi says, all hard talk is just talk. You come here and Ramana heart, blah, 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 it's just talk. He says, you talk about the medicine. You say the name of the medicine over and over and over. You don't take the medicine. He told us very plainly. You know, you're just not doing it. You're not taking the medicine. You're supporting transmigration is what you're doing. So we're not following the advice of the gurus, most people in the world. They're not following the advice. They're not humble enough to feel the wow. Again, yesterday I listened to George Jones, She's Mine song, and I just stopped. And it just went humble. And then just broke down. I just broke down in tears, almost sobbing. I said, man, that was great. I didn't do the liberal thing would be to say, Joe, yeah, let me analyze the song. Okay, how many verses are there? Now, what was the lyric that he said that? Well, that's interesting arrangement there as he goes from there to there. And then I like this pedal steel coming in there. And you're like, I'm smart. See, I'm analyzing. I'm smart. No tears there, right? No tears there. But I just shut up and just let it hit me. Hit me. You know, wow. What a great feeling it is to be hit like that. Here in California, we say take another hit of fresh air in California sunshine. But, you know, there's a yellow, was that a Mustang? Man, so many muscle cars in the Bay Area, in the California is unbelievable. So, take a hit of fresh air in California sunshine. That can give you a wow. But then add on all this other stuff. Keep adding it on until Pama Samava just friended me. Don't think that doesn't wow me. It absolutely does. I'm working on that. That's going to take a while it to sink in. Really. Any of these Dharma kings wow you, it stays with you. It's like a bubble inside you wanting to come burst, you know. It's just, you're like, oh. Now for the liberals, it's like they want B.O. to like them, or Hillary, like, oh, B.O. likes me. You know, it's like, that's so amazing. No. Befriended by Pama Samava, for instance, and experience that. Don't say the ego likes me, an egotist likes me. What good is that? That keeps, that means, oh, my facade is safe. They're not gonna, somebody really important who could puncture my facade is not going to do that, and I feel safe around because they're not going to rock my boat. Oh, I'm so happy about that. This is just stagnating. This is stalling out in transmigration. Transmigration is all just one big stall out, actually. That's all that it is. All these realms, they're just, the realms exist for the purpose of transmigration, for the purpose of feeling that we need to do something with the body, with a body. We don't need to do anything with anybody. We don't need any bodies. We have no spiritual need for any bodies whatsoever. Muscle car mania. I'm still looking for the, you know, I swear, it's a mania here. Everywhere I look, they're Dodge Challengers. And what's the other one? They have another one too. And Mustangs, Ford Mustangs are just selling like crazy. Camaros also. Don't Dodge Charger. I think there's a Dodge Avenger. I don't know if they make those. The Dodge Dart is not a muscle car. But they have the Charger and the Challenger now. And they are just everywhere. Astonishing. The sales success they're having with that. And a lot, same with the Mustang. Camaro, not quite as much. Maybe it's the price point. I don't know how Dodge is doing it. They must be selling them cheap. I don't know. But whatever they did, it's working. It touched a nerve in people, and people want that. I almost want one, you know? It's like, you know? I saw Shelby recently, first one I seen, Shelby. That's a pretty limited edition. I mean, that's a high, pricey Mustang. Ford Cobra, Shelby. It's a modified Mustang or something. But good. It's the poor people, you know, it's the working people's Tesla here. If you can't have a Tesla, get a Jeep Mustang GT, or get a Dodge Charger. At least you can look at the Tesla and say, yeah, I'm fast too. Yeah, you're fast, but I'm fast too. Because Teslas are like the fastest set of wheels in town, because there's no gearing. Everything is just straight to the wheels. Electric motor just generates, you know, straight power. It's completely smooth. There's no pistons, you know, turning a crankshaft, going into the differential, you know. No drive shaft. No crankshaft attached to a drive shaft, attached to a differential, nothing like that. It's just electromagnetic force just turning the wheels directly. So they're very fast. They got governors on them. You can unlock the governors, and they're even faster. And we got Teslas everywhere here. All the, you know, the rich people have Teslas here. That's, you got to have a Tesla. It means you're environmentally, you're nice to the environment. As you put your massive carbon footprint on the world, these rich people have such a massive carbon footprint. It's unbelievable the footprint they have. Liberals, of course, they have the biggest footprints of all, carbon footprints. But they have a Tesla, so they feel like, no, I'm good. Are you good? You got a Tesla too? You're good too. We're all good here, right? Yeah, sure. We're using like 1,000 times more of the Earth's resources than a poor person would, but we got a Tesla, so we feel good about ourselves. We're really doing our part. So they got theirs, and the working class people who do the work, they got their Dodge Chargers and Challengers and Mustangs and Camaros. But they still, I mean, we're waiting for the other shoe to fall. I mean, can we have like a, I don't know, what's the next thing going to be? Honda's put out their new Ridgeline, that truck, which is fast. It's a nice truck. It's really a really great redesign. I was in it, went all through it, and saw everything. Yeah, it's very cool, very cool. Fast, they say it's fast, powerful. But we're back in a muscle car era. We're back in the 70s now, aren't we? Back in the 70s. Trying to redecide, do we really go forward with the Clintons, you know, our liberalism, or maybe that's not where it's at? Well, we know it's not where it's at, except how do you get this, how do you get free from this cult? You know, how do you get free from it, is the question. We don't want them to go down with the Titanic, transmigrate. Titanic's just a transmigration, the addiction to transmigration. It's a belief that something needs to happen. Bodies have to experience something. Bodies have to do something. We don't need anything to happen. We don't need to do anything at all. Mind is already awake. There's only awake mind. That's all there is. There's only awake mind. That's all there is. Some of these little cars are too fast. Some people told me they're too fast. Directly, they're too scary. They're too small. They're too light. They're too fast. The STI, Super STI, too fast. Dangerous. But the muscle cars, you know, at least they got the sound to it. But I don't really like that sound. I don't really like that sound that much. That's the problem. They'd have to quiet the pipes down. Maybe they need to put out a Roadrunner, a new Roadrunner, like a blue Roadrunner. Smooth pipes. I just heard a muscle car in the distance there. Like that. So once the burn is there, don't be in too much of a hurry. Let it burn. If you just do the inner burn, you won't do the outer burn. Right? We don't need to burn the country down. We just turn to this inner burn and burn the ego down. But really, it's just reducing the stock to a nice sauce, evaporating the continuity fear. It's just really just evaporating the continuity fear. Just let it happen. It takes a while. I mean, how long does it take for paint to dry? You do your paint, and then you hang out for a while, and tomorrow, you check it out, and next day, and guess what? It's dry. So just let the paint dry. That's all. How are we doing here? My gosh, we're doing great. Letting the paint dry, just letting the paint dry here. Very important part of it all. I know the activists and all these things. No, I got to do something with the body. I got to please God. No. God didn't make bodies. God doesn't say we need to do something with bodies to please God. That's nonsense. That's nonsense. And any which way you want to slice that pizza, it's still the same nonsense. You want to do it, secularly or religiously or whatever, it's all the same nonsense. We need to do nothing at all. To be what we are. So this is blowing my mind, you gotta do something to blow your mind, really. Truly. Not the sex, drugs, rock and roll. That's out. Because that doesn't really blow your mind. Doesn't matter what combination or whatever you do. It doesn't blow your mind. So then you get desperate. You say, wow, how do I really blow my mind? How do I really get, knocked out? Then you have to really start working at it. You got to work at it. Spiritually work at it. And say, so Ramana said that? He said, he really said that? Oh my God, what? And you go into shock. But it's a positive shock. You're applying heat. And it's starting to boil. So let yourself boil. Let your indignation boil. But it's not that. We lump it all together into the wow. Let the just wow be there. 360 degree wow. And this is how you get out of all cults, whatever cult you're in. We're all in cults, right? We're all cult members, actually, here. Seriously. This is absolutely, seriously true. We're cult members. So when you start to get out of a cult, you're going to feel, you know, this overall wow. Just let the wow be there. That's how you get out of cults. I've gotten out of a lot of cults. It's not easy. You got to work at it. So just take it that you're still in a cult, okay? Don't take it like, ah, no, I'm good. No, no, no. You're still in a cult. Keep working at it. Still in the cult of transmigration. Still in the cult of, yeah, I'm spiritually hip, but you don't understand that, you know, and still in that cult, or, once you see the big picture, then you're able to open up as a guru better and help others set up for their next life so that they can, you know, that'll be their last one. Help them get momentum. So this is just knocking me out. This video is knocking me out. Knock myself out by doing what I do. Every day I knock myself out pretty much all day long. So I'm just schlepping along. Knocked out all day long. Schlepping along, knocked out all day long. Can you dig it? It's already dug. My non-grave is already dug. Can you dig that? Non-grave. My spacious grave is already dug. Our grave is already dug, folks. We don't need to dig a grave. It's already dug for us. It's the grave of doing nothing at all. The grave of no grave. Rest in that grave. The undead grave. The grave for life. That the undead, for the undead, for the eternal life. Rest in that grave. It's a grave without limits, without boundaries. It's a grave that is everywhere. It's the inescapable, everywhere grave. All are in the grave. Eternally in the grave, that grave. Rest in that grave. And forget about the other graves. Those are only temporary graves. You rise from those graves into another body. Transmigration. What kind of grave is that? The religion says, no, we'll sprinkle some holy water on the grave, do some right chants, okay? Don't worry, you won't transmigrate. We will see to it that grave's your final grave. And here you are again. Say, wait a minute. That didn't work. What happened to your sacraments? That didn't work. The grave didn't hold me, son of a gun. Right. Our fear of death is that the grave won't hold us. So we have these religions that promise, no, the grave will hold you. We'll make sure we'll put you in a concrete box in the ground. That'll hold you. Or else we'll burn you. We'll incinerate you. That'll hold you. Now, guess what? It didn't hold you. You escaped from the grave, and here you are again. Oh, my gosh. Doggone it. How do I make sure the grave will finally hold me? Well, the grave-free grave will hold you. No grave will actually hold you. So accept the infinite grave, the eternal grave, where there's no definition to the grave at all. The grave of no definition, the formless grave. You must crawl into the formless grave or actually realize there's no crawling in or in or out. You've always been there. No matter how strong your legs are, there's always a workout you can do that's just gonna, turn them into spaghetti, into jello. That's the thing, right? Say, oh man, can I? No, there's always something you can do. Boy, that hike I took, I've never experienced that before in my life. I stopped and my whole body was trembling and shaking and I was losing my balance back and forth. And I said, I can hardly stand up, actually. Can hardly stand up. I don't know if I'm going to fall. I need to lean on my staff. Good Lord. That was pretty interesting. That was pretty cool to feel that. Realize just how flimsy our muscles really are. We keep thinking that we're a rock, our body's a rock. No, hey, I could take you on a workout where your legs are gonna, you're gonna have to hold on so you don't collapse. Then you realize your body's not such a rock, is it? Just exceed the limits in some way, and that's it. So where's the rock? Well, the formless grave is the rock. The non-definable grave. We say grave is our resting place. We want to rest in peace there. We're tired of this world. We want to just go somewhere to crawl in a grave and really rest in peace. Oh, she's finally at peace now, they say. Really? No, transmigrating, furiously transmigrating. So I didn't quite do enough. I still feel nervous. There's still something that I need to avoid. I got to keep my definitions going. Now find the true grave. Abide in intrinsic the true grave of intrinsic spaciousness, the perfect graveyard. Yeah. I usually don't talk about graveyards, but this is funny to me. It's like a liberal embracing Trump, me talking, embracing the idea of graveyards, really. It's like, what am I talking about? But yeah, let's find the real graveyard. I'm still looking at this. Let's find that true graveyard. These other ones, man, they don't hold you worth a darn. You pop right out of them, pop back up. What? And we've invited intrinsic spaces. Ah, I finally found my true resting place, my true graveyard. Everybody else, they just keep popping out of the graves. They keep manufacturing these graves and they keep popping out of them. They say, doggone it. That's what happens. You keep transmigrating. I love Trump. Hey, I'm gonna send you. I'll get a cafe press store for all liberals. Liberals who love Trump. Liberals love Trump. Wear that T-shirt around, and see what happens to your social life, and ask yourself, am I living in a cult, actually? Have a big heart. It says Trump underneath it. Heart, big red heart, Trump. Wear that to your next cocktail party. And to see if you get disinvited to any more cocktail parties. People look at you like, you realize, gee, their expressions are not so peaceful after all. They suddenly threw me this completely perplexed, flustered, you know, like that facade just. I thought, nice, smiley, sleek, hip, smart, intelligent liberals here. And suddenly they're like looking at you like they just looked into the eye of the hurricane, the eye of a great white shark. Suddenly you turned into a great white shark right in front of them. Wow, metamorphosis, amazing. Shape shifting, I just turned into a great white shark. And like, they suddenly don't know what to do anymore. It's like, oh my gosh, what happened? I just wore a t-shirt, what's going on? listen, the graves that they're digging, not going to hold them, okay? That's not going to, a liberal grave is not going to hold you. You're going to pop right out of that grave. Come on. Conservative grave also is not going to hold you. But since you're believing in a liberal grave is going to hold you, make doggone sure that you start disbelieving in that. Okay, whatever grave you think is going to hold you, other than the formless, definitionless grave, you're going to pop out of that grave. So you better stop believing in it, okay? You better stop believing in it, or you will most certainly try it out again. Let me die a good Trump-hating liberal, and maybe that'll the grave will hold me this time. No, it won't. You'll pop right out of it, like a jack-in-the-box. But God, I did everything right, and I hated Trump. I loathed him. I hated him so much. And what do you mean? I'm back. Wow. I'm not too happy about that. God says, what does Trump have to do with anything? What are you talking about? What are you talking about? Just listen to the gurus. They'll set you straight. That's why I sent them. That's what God will say. I sent them here to help you, free you from your, you know, belief that you need to define what you are. In other words, the body finally has to find the self, meaning find the right definition, the correct definition. So we're all going to university trying to find out what the correct definitions are. So one of them is, I hate Trump. That's one of the correct definitions. And so let me try that one and add some more on to it. Some moron. Adding moron is a moron. We're all morons, aren't we? I got to find that, just the correct grave. And then I'll finally be finished with all this suffering, God. The correct grave. No grave is the correct grave. The definition-free grave is the right grave. The formless grave is the right grave. Rest in that formless, definition-free grave. You can't pop out of that grave, can you? How can you pop out of a grave that has no form, no definition whatsoever? How can you pop out of that grave? So guess what? No more effort needed, right? You're not popping out of the grave. You're at rest. You're at ease. You're not struggling with the body anymore, are you? Not transmigrating. I'm struggling with another body. This isn't just a body, a struggle. It's a total struggle. I can't sleep anymore. My muscles ache. If I work out, I'm strong, but my muscles ache and I'm tired. If I don't work out, I'm weak, and I can't move around, and I'm tired. So either way, it's a struggle. Everything's a struggle. But the liberals try to act like, well, no, I'm not struggling with my body. No. Driving my Tesla, where's the struggle? No struggle. I'm sleek, I'm elegant, I shop at the right places, I have the right ideologies, correct definitions, my grave, I'm digging a really nice grave. It's the undug grave is the real grave. Rest in the undug grave. The grave that was never dug. See, this is a mind blower, isn't it? It's like, you can't say that. You can't say what you just said. Oops, you did say it. Wow. Too late. I'm in the wow already. See, I found my grave at last. The undug grave. The dimensionless grave. The boundless grave. The free grave. The blissful grave. The definition free grave. Found my grave at last. Cannot transmigrate. If you can't transmigrate, then why do you need to die then? Right? Death is just for the purpose of transmigrating. But once you find the undug grave, there's no more transmigration as possible. So why do you need to die? You don't have to. I mean, the death ends for you. The body's still present, but death has ended for you. Because really, death is just transmigration. This is the vision that Padmasambhava gave me. It's so helpful what he did for me. I asked him at Wauchella, the last day of Wauchella, I said, Padmasambhava, I'm asking you, I want to meet you. Okay, I've agreed that I'm willing to meet you. This is what I want. And he gave me this transmission. And it's changed everything. It's just been immeasurably helpful to see transmigration as it is. Shifted my entire perspective on all of this. And it's just, wow, what can I say? It should be obvious to you that this is, you know, there's a greater depth here. That's because of Padmasambhava. And my willingness to meet with him. So, in the undug grave, no transmigration is possible. So, it's the end of death, isn't it? It really is. You can't get another body. It's meaningless. So why then dropping this body doesn't get you anything, does it? There's no face that needs to be saved anymore. So we don't need to save face by dying. Where are we at? 3 days. Okay. It really just shifts everything. Yeah. You know? So just get used to this. Remember, the knockout is the gratitude to the gurus. Being knocked out is the gratitude. You don't have to generate gratitude in your feeling. Just be knocked out in the wow. And that means that you took it to heart what they had to transmit. You took it to heart. That's what they're looking for. That is, that they say, ah, that's the gratitude. They say, yeah, someone really took it to heart what, allowed the transmission to take place. Thank you. They thank us for that. That's the thanks.